Good evening. I want to ask the students in the audience to come sit up front. It's not your lectures or church. So if you're in my class, you're standing up and coming to the front or you don't get your bonus points. Yeah. That got some people moving, didn't it? See? This makes me feel better. I still have some pull.
So, where would you like to put me in your weak moment? Stand there and then I'll come up?
Would you like to just stand right here? I'm going to stand behind you.
Make it informal. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Yeah,
that's good. It won't take long. No.
Yeah, well, just a little is fine.
A little bit. So, yeah, maybe we'll be here.
Yeah, yeah. Good.
All right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
If you, I'm going to mention about the plug on the website.
Perfect. All right. Thank you very much for coming to the third Larry Nelson Memorial Lecture. My name is Jeffrey Bibby. I'm the chair of the Department of History here at UNA. Some of the students here may think that history can be dull and boring, but I think we will dispel any issue with that tonight. This is probably the most exciting history event we've ever had at UNA. It's also part of a collection of events that have been occurring at our university over the last several weeks. The renaming of our Commons Building in honor of Wendell Gunn, the first African-American student at UNA. Last week, we commemorated the anniversary of the assassination of Dr. King. And then, of course, tonight. And I think it shows that UNA and the Department of History and the College of Arts and Sciences are working hard to talk about difficult issues, social justice, diversity and inclusion, and we're glad that you're here to be part of that conversation. I want to thank the departmental faculty that are here tonight, who work tirelessly during the year on behalf of our students. I want to thank Mrs. Jean Boffman, who does yeoman's work for the History Department and keeps us all moving in the right direction and has worked very hard to make tonight possible. I'd also like to thank the College of Arts and Sciences and our Dean, Carmen Burkhalter. Dean Burkhalter. Thank you very much for being here. And also the Office of Student Engagement, who helped provide financial support for tonight's event. I'm going to turn it over to Matt Schoenbackler and Matt, if everything goes well, we'll share the credit. Right. And if it doesn't, then it can all be yours. Yeah. But Matt has worked very hard to make this event possible and has been committed to making sure that our Nelson Lecture each year has been one of the best events in our university calendar. So I will turn it over to Matt to take control of the evening. Thanks, Matt.
Thank you. And thank you, Jeff. Good evening. The History Department of the University of North Alabama welcomes you to the third annual Lawrence J. Nelson Memorial Lecture, a series that honors the memory of longtime UNA professor Larry Nelson. Tonight, we have two honored guests, Verley Nelson, Dr. Nelson's wife. Verley, would you please stand? And Julie Nelson Strickland, his daughter, Julie. Thank you both for joining us this evening. Lawrence John Nelson was born on October 20th, 1944, in Joliet, Illinois. He received his bachelor's degree from Evangel College in 1996 and his doctorate at the University of Missouri, in 1972. After pursuing postgraduate studies at Fuller Theological Seminary in Pasadena, California, Larry taught at his alma mater, Evangel College, for 6 years. In 1985, he accepted a position here at UNA, where he would teach for the next 30 years. As it turned out, Dr. Nelson's first semester in UNA was my first semester at UNA. That, however, is where the similarities ended. Dr. Nelson was a seasoned teacher and a published scholar, whereas I, at 18, was pretty much ignorant of the existence of ideas. But in January 1986, I wandered into Dr. Larry Nelson's class in Bibb Graves Hall and I knew something was different. Having been up to that point, taught history by football coaches, I had no idea what a serious engagement with the past might actually look and sound like. Every day, the blackboards were littered with titles of books and articles. His knowledge of history seemed endless. And then, too, he spoke of historians, letting us in on a great secret. History is not something that just happened and was then dutifully recorded. History was the result of humans reconstructing, interpreting, and debating accounts of the past. Dr. Nelson not only taught generations of young people how about the past, he taught us how to think. And we learned, and as we learned more and more history, our world, our time became so much more comprehensible. Even as he passionately taught his students, Larry found time to publish two books, King Cotton's Advocate in 1988 and Rumors of Indiscretion in 2004. As well, he left behind a manuscript, a fascinating account of Nikita Khrushchev's 1959 visit to the United States that will soon be published. On January 14th, 2014, Lawrence John Nelson died at the age of 69 after an 8-month battle with brain cancer. Although his passing left a void that can never be filled, this lecture series, we hope, can help continue his life's mission to help people understand the wonders of the past. And you too can contribute. If you go to the UNA History Department website, you can donate to the Nelson Speaker Fund. We need your generosity to help keep this lecture series going. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Jonathan Rieder, a distinguished sociologist and faculty member at Barnard College and Columbia University in New York City. A regular contributor to the New York Times Book Review and a contributing editor to the New Republic, Dr. Rieder is also the author of two books that analyze the life and message of Martin Luther King, The Gospel of Freedom, 2013, and The Word of the Lord is Upon Me, 2008. Currently, he is writing and researching a book that explores the intersection of music, race, and politics over three generations of Alabama musicians. And this, of course, is a story in which the Shoals area plays a central role. Tonight, as Dr. Rieder presents I'll Take You There, Martin Luther King and the Shoals musical tradition, he will be joined by special musical guests. Together, Dr. Rieder and these accomplished musicians will help teach us a great truth. History is not just the fading words and images of people long gone. Rather, history is all around us. History is within us. We move through a world shaped by generations long gone. As William Faulkner put it over six decades ago, the past is never dead. It's not even past. A century earlier, Abraham Lincoln played upon the same theme. Fellow citizens, he said, we cannot escape history. And as we attempt to come to terms with this great and unyielding reality, we all become, in one way or another, historians. So when Donnie Fritz sings of a friendship across the color line in an age of segregation, he too is doing history. When Jay Burgess sings of a murdered civil rights activist, he is doing history. When Terrence Brown performs a 19th century African American spiritual, he is an historian, telling us of the cruelties of slavery and the strength of the human spirit. When the ascending voices sing How I Got Over, they demonstrate how a racist incident in the Jim Crow South was transformed into an anthem of defiance. And when John Paul White sings You're Gonna Die, he reminds us of history's greatest lesson. Tonight, Dr. Rieder and his musical guests all bear witness to what Larry Nelson taught his students. History is both indispensable and inescapable. So now, help me welcome the great sociologist and historian, Dr. Jonathan Rieder.
So I'm going to try this without the microphone. Usually I don't need it. Can people hear in the back or not?
Yes.
Okay. If not, just tell me to raise my voice and I'll go to the mic. So thank you, Matt. I want to thank you for many things, not least of all, really, the role you played in making tonight happen. A true scholar, passionate about teaching, He's also one of the best people to hang out with and talk about politics and music, and I'm grateful for that. I want to thank the History Department, especially the Nelson family. In this particular moment in American history, it's especially important when too many people are creating false histories and digital fabrications to have old-fashioned evidence-based journalism and academic work. To our musical participants tonight, I'm fans of all, and I'm really thrilled to be able, in their presence, you can see from the program, many of the, all of them but are established musicians, but I want to call out especially the young folks from UNA, from Ascending Voices. Thank you for being here. I'm sure you're on your way to recognition as well. And finally, to the larger Shoals community, who've given this stranger their insight and time and plenty of good times as well. And I'll just say two institutions in particular deserve some special thanks. The folks at Syncalock Records, who are really good people as well as producing some unbelievable music, and the entire crew at Rivertown Coffee, without which I couldn't get any job, any work or any interviewing done. And finally, two people who really stand out for having educated this Yankee, the great Tory Bailey and Dick Cooper, who are treasures to this community. Thank you. So I'm going to move pretty quickly tonight because I'm not going to do this as a straight scholarly talk. Some of you will be reassured. When we're celebrating Dr. King in the music of the Shoals, we need to be in the spirit, and we're depending on all of our musical accompaniments to get us in that spirit. I hear America singing, Walt Whitman famously wrote, the carpenter measuring his plank, shoemaker on his bench, each singing what belongs to him or her, but no one else. And I think Whitman got something wrong. He was a little bit off key there, because sometimes a song is not just personal. Sometimes it lifts a whole group and gives them spirit. Sometimes it allows people to enter another group's community. And at its best, it can lift the spirits of an entire nation towards its better angels. Which brings me to tonight. Where better to witness American singing in this place of the Singing River and all the musical history that overflows its banks? So one of my twin tasks tonight is to celebrate the musical connections that black and white artists made back in the day, and to celebrate some of the music today that is coming out of this town that has the same sense of spirit and engagement. And where better to honor Martin Luther King than in the state where King's efforts in Montgomery and Birmingham and Selma would help make this nation what it's meant to be. So I rarely read my talks, and I'm not mainly going to read, but I've also got to get a lot of music in here, and I don't want to digress at all, so I may read a little bit. And though I'm not going to give a scholarly talk, my work is informed through almost two decades of listening to King. I decided to know King, you had to get beyond his public addresses to the larger society, I Have a Dream, and listen to what he sounded like in black churches and mass meetings. And I also spent a lot of time with King's closest, especially his preacher buddies, that wild group of colleagues who gave so much to make this nation what it has become. So I really have a simple academic theme, that the image we have of King is very simple, and I want to introduce a somewhat richer vision of Dr. King than the man who was a dreamer. Yes, he dreamed, but we don't even understand what he meant by that dream. And so I'll proceed in seven movements, each of which is the equivalent of a musical movement and which will have a song attached to it. First movement, consecration. In 1965, King declared, "I come to Selma to say tonight that you are God's children and you are somebody. I come to tell you every man from bass black to treble white is significant on God's keyboard."
And back in that Jim Crow time when racial separation ruled in the Shoals and all through Alabama, black and white musicians found a way to play on that keyboard together. Now, in recent years, some writers have said this is too rosy a take on it. And it's true. There are some black musicians I've talked to who feel we didn't have access to the capital to create music studios, like some of the white musicians. And they're not bitter, but they're telling the truth. And some remembers the time right downtown in right on Court Street when a policeman that he knew from high school came up to him and he knew that blacks and whites were meeting over that drugstore and he said, "We know what you blacks and whites are doing," though he didn't say blacks, "and a lot of people here don't like it." So we don't want to overly romanticize, but on the other hand, it's no romance to say that there's much to consecrate in what these musicians, people of different races, were doing to scale the walls that divided them. Tory Bailey's father, Bob Carl, who was the founder of WZZA and Jukebox Jim, forging a relationship in the old Shoals. Two rough characters, Wilson Pickett, the Wicked Pickett, and Rick Hall, eyeing each other suspiciously through the lens of racial mistrust, getting to carve out a relationship. Candy Staten remembering when Rick and Candy were in a Muscle Shoals restaurant and people looking at black and white together, and Rick saying, "What are you looking at?" That was Rick. Your legendary Swampers, Jimmy and David and Barry and Roger, who would go on to make music with Aretha and the Staple Singers. And here's the simple sociological point I want to make. Playing music together changed what whites understood about race in many ways. Jimmy Johnson put it to me this way. Here we were, having heard about the inferiority of blacks, and we're meeting these beautiful black people, and we were angry because we felt we had been lied to. That's the heart speaking. The camaraderie, the antics, the family feeling among Fame Gang, the Horn guys, Harrison and Charles and Harvey and Ron Ides. As Harrison said, we were family. Such intimate contact gave whites a chance to walk in black shoes. Donnie Fritz and Spooner Oldham with Arthur Alexander down in Birmingham. And I believe it was Spooner. I think Spooner went into the restaurant. I think Donnie was in the car with Arthur. And the waitress says, "Are you with the black and white guys in the car?" Again, she didn't say black. And she said, "Well, I've been watching this car circle the block, and my advice is the next time they come around here, make sure you're out of here." So I end this section on Donnie Fritz and Arthur Alexander, because it will lead into our first song. They were there for one another, protected one another, cared about one another, and we are now so happy. Oh, I'm sorry, let me just not jump ahead so quickly. I'm too eager to get the musicians out here. At his funeral, Donnie would recite the following words. "Oh, how we loved our good friend, June." Arthur was known as June. "But 62 was a turbulent time. There were white sheets and bomb threats and R&B crimes. We went through some things we did not understand, but it made me and June much closer friends. He was my brother, I'm proud to say." And I am just so honored to have Donnie Fritz along with John Paul White. This is the first time this poem converted into a song, which will be on Donnie's forthcoming album. This is the first time I believe this song has been performed in public. Donnie and John Paul.
Thank you very much. It's good to be here. And I'd like to just at first say a little bit about the song we're going to do. It's a song I wrote the day Arthur died. Arthur Alexander, if y'all who don't know, he had the first hit out of Muscle Shoals. And we were very close friends from 1958 on, so you can see we were just kids when we met. Anyway, he passed away in 93, and I was driving back home. We were in Nashville where he passed away. I was driving back home, and I wrote this song for Arthur. It's called June. Now all of us called him June because he was Arthur Alexander Jr. So that's how we got June. All right. Well, I met him when I was only 16. We could not believe how the big man could sing. And to our surprise, he wrote his own tunes. What a talent, the man we call June. Soon he was singing, you better move on. We all were so proud of June's first hit song. He lived like he sang, he was always in tune. How he loved our good friend June. But 1962, y'all, was a turbulent time. There were white sheets, bomb threats, and rhythm and blues cries. Lord, we went through a lot of things we did not understand. You know what? It made me and June such close friends. He was my brother. I'm so proud to say, because he was here, the world's a much better place. He didn't stay long, no. He left us much too soon. How we miss our good friend June. How I love my good friend June. Thank you very much.
Movement 2, Inspiration. In the early 1960s, brotherhood might be found at the dark end of the street. Upstairs above a drugstore, out in Jackson Highway, inside the studio. But beyond those sanctuaries, there was trouble in the land. Sweet Home Alabama was not a sweet home for African American citizens who weren't even citizens at that time. But here's one little twist. Singing about freedom might actually help bring freedom. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. We shall overcome. The slaves had prepared the way. Denied their own religion, force-fed a distorted version of Christianity that reduced to obey the master, They saw themselves in Exodus, and the Israelites in the house of bondage. And so they sang, "Let my people go. And did my Lord deliver Daniel, and why not every man? I've been rebuked and scorned, but Jesus loves me, and he died on a cross for me." King Martin Luther King always paid homage to the slaves, and his ancestor worship often took the form of shouting out to their music. This is King speaking. "So many of our forebears used to sing about freedom, and they dreamed of the day they'd be able to get out of the bosom of slavery. And they would say, 'I'm so glad the trouble don't last always. By and by, I'm going to lay down my heavy load.'" Now, the force and beauty of this music would be present in Birmingham in the spring of 1963. Victory there would lead to the March on Washington and the Civil Rights Act of 1964, but at first the movement faltered. King was despondent. He went to jail on Good Friday, came out, and still the movement was dead. It was the young children of Birmingham who accomplished what the elders had not, climbing out those windows of Parker High School, assembling at 16th Street Baptist Church, and all the while they sang the songs of the slaves. But they tweaked them. "I'm on my way to Canaan" became "I'm on my way to freedom." Now let's think about what that means. What were they doing? The hope of deliverance in the next world was being transformed into a pledge of people to deliver themselves in this world. The church doors burst open and the youngsters went up against the brute force of Bull Connor and the dogs and the fire hoses, and they sang, "I woke up with my mind stayed on freedom." All the while, the propulsive force of their voices neutralized the propulsive force of the hoses. They had a fire, King would say, that no water could put out. I give you the ascending voices to carry us out the church doors, 16th Street Baptist Church.
I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was a stable. Yeah, hey, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stay on freedom. Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stay. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stayed. Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stayed on freedom. Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stayed. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Yeah, I'm walking and talking with my mind, and it is staying. Yeah, I'm walking and talking with my mind, and it is stating on freedom. Yeah, I woke up this morning with my mind, and it was stating, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Ain't nothing wrong with having my mind stayed. Yeah, ain't nothing wrong with me having my mind stayed on freedom. Hey, ain't nothing wrong with me having my mind stayed. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.
Thank you.
Movement 3, Lamentation. Right after the dogs and the hoses were deployed, King was almost speechless. It was as almost as if the brutality had taken away his eloquence, and all he could manage was almost childlike simplicity. Birmingham was a mean town today. They were mean to us. But as you listen to King preaching in 16th Street Baptist Church, just moments after this, he regains his defiance and says, "But our black faces will stand up to their fire hoses and their water." The dogs and the fire hoses, of course, stood for a broader tragic history. And how would King deal with that? That history inspired in King many different responses, but one was the one he showed in Letter from Birmingham Jail, the angry prophet who chastises evil. "It's not just the haters," he says. "We will have to repent for the appalling silence of the good people." He hits white people for a lack of empathy. He says it's an unfortunate thing that most members of the oppressor race cannot understand, and he's using Exodus language, the groans and longings of the oppressed people. And then he goes on his road trip, because as a Christian minister addressing what are supposed to be the most moderate ministers in Alabama at the time, and they've criticized him, and he's thinking, where is their vision of the gospel? They're accusing me of extremism. And he goes on a road trip in Letter from Birmingham Jail, and he says, "I've often driven past through the South and noticed the majestic spires of your churches. And I've wondered what kind of people worship here. Who is their God? Where were their voices when Governor Wallace gave a clarion call of hatred? I have heard white ministers say, obey desegregation laws because you should obey the law. I have longed to hear them declare this decree to follow desegregation because integration is morally right and the Negro is your brother." So that was King the prophet, not the dreamer. But in the refuge of the black church, a different King emerged. The healer of black pain, who brought balm to the afflicted. And in one of his great moments, in a little church in a black belt town, King notes the Statue of Liberty talks about America as a home to exiles, the mother of exiles. Think about that. America is the mother to her exiles. And then you hear a king lament. You imagine the tears welling up. America has never evinced the same maternal care for her black exiles. And isn't it the ultimate irony that the Negro could sing in one of his sorrow songs, "Sometimes I feel like a motherless child"? As the audience erupted in applause, King demanded, "What sense of estrangement, what sense of rejection, what sense of hurt could cause a people to use such a metaphor?" To capture that powerful emotion, we have the powerful voice of Dr. Terrence Brown of the University of North Alabama. After all those songs, I just need to compose myself a minute. But I can do it. Movement 4, exaltation. Few moments of King's oratory are as exalted as the end of "I Have a Dream" at the March on Washington, the bells of freedom ringing, Isaiah's vision of the rough places being made plain. Yet that speech has not really been properly understood. Even the dream wasn't that dreamy. And here again, song, two songs, played a great part on the Mall that day. The first song comes when King, he's halfway through that speech, and you have to remember, he planned not to do "I Have a Dream" that day. And John Lewis, the great civil rights icon, told me that he heard Mahalia Jackson say, "Tell him about the dream, Martin." And if you notice that King read the first half of the dream, he never read speeches, but he was concerned about President Kennedy and the Civil Rights Bill. But halfway through, he stops reading, and he's preaching in a very restrained way, given that he's worried about those congressmen. The first song comes when King imagines blacks singing "My Country, 'Tis of Thee." He says, "And I have a dream that one day my children will live in a country where they won't be judged by the color of their skin." Now let's dwell on the phrase "one day." What is King saying but that country doesn't yet exist? The land of liberty hasn't yet been born. And there's another intricacy to the dream. Even before King introduces the dream, he is turned away from talking to white America. And he says, I know that some of you have come here from trials and tribulations. He's talking about the civil rights workers who've come up from Mississippi and Alabama. So he's addressing them now. I am not unmindful that some of you have come from trials and tribulations which left you battered and staggered. And he says, go back to Mississippi, go back to Alabama. And he bucks them up and says, don't wallow in despair because I have a dream. The dream is first addressed to the freedom fighters before King pivots and extends the dream to everyone. Once he's done that dream sequence, he says, with that face, and this is really important, we will struggle together, go to jail together, fight for freedom together. Only then, King says, will all of God's children be able to sing with new meaning, my country, tis of thee, sweet land of liberty. You can't really sing that song until the civil rights movement completes making America a democratic nation. Having defined the conditions for singing, King's finale is then a moment of exultant prophecy. That's when he's able to come to the second song that ends it, right? The words of the old Negro spiritual. He ends with a black voice. God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics. And he was a man of his time. I have no doubt that if he was here in this era, he would have said, and gays and straights and other people who are God's children, we'll be able to join hands and sing the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. And now, having merged white voices with the voices of the slaves, he continues, thank God Almighty, we are free at last. Now let's focus a moment on that we that cries out, we are free. King has already packed that we with blacks and whites and Jews and Gentiles. In that brilliant flash of preaching, King made white people symbolically experience bondage and freedom. We are free. We can sing as a whole nation, we are free, because if someone is unfree, nobody is free. On the Mall that day, King asked Mahalia Jackson to sing one of his favorite songs, another song of exultation, How I Got Over.
How I got over, how I got over, you know my soul, look back and wonder how I got over, how I got over, oh, how I got over, well, you know my soul, look back and wonder how I got over. Now tell me how I got over. Oh, how I got over. Well, you know my soul. Look back and wonder how I got over. Now soon as I can see Jesus, the man that died for me, the man who bled and suffered, you know he hung on Calvary. I want to thank him for how he brought me. I want to thank him for how he taught me. I want to thank him for how he kept me. I want to thank him because he never left me. I want to thank him for old time religion. I want to thank him for heavenly vision. One day I'll join the heavenly choir. You know I sing and never get tired. And then we're going to sing around God's altar. And then we're going to shout, all my troubles over. And then I'll thank him. Thank him for being so good to me. Now tell me how I got over.
Oh, how I got over.
You know my soul. Look back and wonder how I got over. I'm gonna wear a diadem in that new Jerusalem. I'm gonna walk the streets of gold. It's in the homeland of the soul. I'm gonna view the host in white that's been traveling both day and night. Coming up from every nation on their way to the great coronation. Coming from the north, south, east, and west on their way to a land of rest. And then we're gonna join the heavenly choir. We're gonna sing and never get tired. And then we're gonna sing around God's altar. And then we're gonna shout, all my troubles over. And then I'll thank him. Thank him for being so good to me. Now tell me how I got over.
How I got over.
How I got over. How I got over. Well, I want to thank him this evening. I want to thank God this evening. You know, all night long, God kept his angels watching over me. And early this morning, God told his angels, God said, touch him in my name. God said, touch him in my name. I rose this morning. I rose this morning. I rose this morning. I rose this morning. And I feel like shouting. I feel like shouting. I just gotta thank God. I just gotta thank him. And then I'll thank him for being so. Me.
Just want to reassure people, because I know people have families to get back to and homework to do and other things. We're on pace, so we got a lot more soulful sounds coming, but we'll be done in about 30 minutes, so it's all good. Movement 5, commiseration. Feel sympathy for others. In the late 1950s, King was back from India and up in the pulpit down in Montgomery, hadn't gone to Atlanta yet. And King recounted how when he was in India, he was introduced as a fellow untouchable. And you hear the congregation, the Dexter Baptist, going, oh, my, my. And King says, at first I was a bit peeved and shocked to be introduced that way. But he says, but then I thought about it and I said, wait a second. I thought of the degradations of Jim Crow and my brothers and sisters in poverty, and I said to myself, yes, I am an untouchable. And every Negro in America is an untouchable. What King was saying is what binds people in common humanity far outweighs the labels of class and race, of nation and religion that divide us. And this was key to King's preaching. He says, I'm not just a civil rights leader of black people. I believe in all God's children. His empathy extended to the poor of Calcutta, poor whites in Appalachia, as well as poor blacks in Marks, Mississippi. This ethos of empathy and the duty to care and the ability to see oneself as somebody different from you in recent years has become important in the work of a number of white Alabama and especially Muscle Shoals area connected rock and roll and alternative country and independent singer-songwriter artists. On St. Paul and the Broken Bones second album, Paul Janeway plays with this disturbing scenario. He imagines a parent as the killer of Trayvon Martin. He says, that's my daddy with a gun killing someone else's son. And I don't have time to go into the details, but imagine the intricacy. Is Paul making himself, he's a son, so he is like Trayvon Martin, who's a son. Jason Isbell's White Man's World complicates this act of perception. In the process, he underscores the hidden history that we walk over and past and around without realizing it. He says, I have the bones of the red men under my feet. People are worried about removing history, but a partial history can be a way of denying history. And that history of the bones of the red man, vampire-like, or a ghostly presence. And then he thinks again about all the times he laughed at a racist joke and said nothing. These artists are not afraid to confront a painful history and thus to own the history in some sense. Just as King invited everyone to share black bondage and deliverance, we all are free at last. These songs are saying we don't need separate monuments. We're all entangled in a shared history. Now, it may not sound obvious to herald as icons of empathetic caring, a group whose one of his early albums would call Alabama Ass Whoopin'. But few white rockers have sought to correct false and partial history as two songwriters whose paths crossed at the University of North Alabama, Patterson Hood and Michael Cooley. It's fair to think of them as truth tellers. And again, I'm going to cut it short because I can't do 4 minutes on the truckers. I can do 30 seconds or an hour and a half. But I just want to note two things that are important. First, the truckers have always treated the rejected and dejected white exiles from the American dream, the drug dealer in putting a man on the moon, whose wife dies of cancer because they don't have health insurance and she can't afford the chemo. The truckers have treated that white world with sympathy underneath their badass bravado. The word kindly in your kindly grandpa who believes in states' rights rescues the kindly grandpa from being a deplorable. There is a sense of humanizing somebody who is part of their family. In Southern Thing, Hood tells about the memory of his grandfather with a bullet hole from Shiloh. Ain't no plantations in my family tree. But none of this is defensive maneuvers. As the truckers say elsewhere, ain't about excuses, ain't about alibis. And as they describe the duality of the Southern white person, they say, and it's fact, if you are proud of the glory of the Southern heritage, and they believe certainly there is much to be proud of, you need to stare down the shame. You can't have one history and pretend the other one doesn't exist. The trick of the truckers has always been to see with double vision without blurred vision. To reclaim history means excavating unsettling history. However kindly, Patterson says, the right he's talking about was the right for one man to own another. We raise our children steeped in Gone with the Wind folklore and pretend that all the things we saw in 12 Years a Slave didn't happen. Now notice what the truckers are saying as they play around, and I can't do justice to the intricacy of their point of view, but they're saying, they're not telling black stories, it's telling all of our stories. And thus have the truckers come to draping Black Lives Matter signs on their amplifiers. Capturing the intimate voice, the Polly Song Jackson owns this shared history audaciously. The songwriter and lead singer Jay Burgess tells the story of Jimmie Lee Jackson killed in the run-up to the Selma protests, but he tells the story not as an observer on the sidelines. He becomes Jimmie Lee Jackson the better to tell that story. Capturing the intimate voice of son and mother, Burgess, become Jimmie Lee Jackson, says, wake up, mama, we're going to join the king on the Pettus Bridge in Selma. But for me, the emotional pivot comes in the middle stanza. Calm down, mama, we got to find a place to hide. The lawmen came without warning, they came for our lives. In truth, the Alabama state troopers had come storming into Mac's Cafe in Marion, Alabama, and began to beat Viola Jackson, the mom. And when her son Jimmy tried to protect her, they shot and killed him. The Polly's effort, Jay's effort to evoke and experience black suffering might be taken as an acceptance of Dr. King's invitation and letter from Birmingham jail. An indignant King has lost his scholarly cool, and he's getting tired of the white clergy telling him to wait, wait for a better time. And King says, that's all we've ever heard, wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This is an angry King beneath all the fancy philosophy of Martin Buber and Paul Tillich. Having tried to move the clergy with appeals to their religion and reason, King now offers to take them on a tour of black life. When you've seen vicious mobs lynch your mothers and fathers, when you've seen hate-filled policemen curse, kick, and even kill your black brothers and sisters, on and on King hammers away, when you, for a sentence that has 276 words in it. And only then does King pull out of that swoon and say, now maybe you will understand why we find it hard to wait. What had King done there? What he did is given whites intimate access to the inner recesses of black pain. He was inviting them to cross over to feel what it feels like to be on the other side of the Jim Crow border. He was being generous in another sense. He was gambling that whites might respond to pathos in ways they had not to their own alleged moral and civic principles. To honor that conception of crossing over into the other person, I give you Jay Burgess of the Polly's. Fabulous group. They have so much other great songs besides Jackson. But Jay, come on out and give us Jackson. Thank you so much.
pretty good.
Children, they gonna wanna hear it too. 600 strong across that Edmund Pettus Bridge, and we won't stop for no lawmen till they get it fixed. We all dream of being lonely. No, it's not an easy thing to do, but we gotta get what is left of yours and mine. And if not, we all lose. Come on, mama, we gotta find a place to hide. No man came with that warning, and they came for lives. And come down, mama, now, honey, don't you cry. 'Cause there's a man around the corner, and it's either you or I. We all dream of being lonely. No, it's not an easy thing to do. We gotta give what was left of yours and mine. And if not, we all lose. Come on, mama, we got a little to do. The king has came with his men, and they want you to march strong across that Edmund Pettus Bridge, and you won't stop for no lawmen till they get it fixed.
We come to our two final movements. 6, commemoration. On the last night of his life, King went flying into the Exodus story, made himself Moses, climbed up to the mountaintop, and he peered over at the promised land. I may not get there with you. He had already told the crowd that he was ready for whatever came. But more often for King, it was Jesus rather than Moses who defined the sacrificial character of his Christian part of the civil rights movement. Some people would have to die so others would live. That's why King went to jail on Good Friday. He would suffer on the cross like his Lord. Death was only one of the difficulties the movement and King faced. And in the mass meetings, King tended not to show his vulnerability. He was prone to discouragement, but he had to buck up the freedom fighters. He had to stay strong for them, but in the church, he would sometimes show the vulnerable side of him. In the refuge of the black church, King would preach, "Oh, I get discouraged in Alabama." King wasn't a whooper like C.L. Franklin or Daddy King, but he had that tremolo, whoa, which was his stand-in for whooping. King constantly swung between morning and midnight. and usually he found solace in the certainties of his faith. My God is able. There is a balm in Gilead. After the crucifixion is the resurrection. The promised land follows the house of bondage in the wilderness. But King also took solace in the metaphor of creating a song. In his sermon, The Interruptions of Life, King tells the story of a jilted lover who jumped off a bridge and killed himself. And he ends by imploring the congregation, don't jump this morning. Oh, I would say to you, Handel was down low, but he didn't jump. And I'm glad he didn't jump because in the last minute, he wrote the Hallelujah Chorus and the Great Messiah. Don't jump, go produce a song. And there are times in those same kind of moments which King is anticipating spiraling down into fear of death and losing his children. And he breaks into that gospel song. Again, he usually didn't sing the climaxes of his sermon, but he said, but I heard the voice of Jesus saying, still to fight on. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me, never to leave me. So King knew how to think of death. And Andy Young told me the story that sometimes he did it with humor. Andrew Young and Fred Shuttlesworth, Andrew, and a few others were with King before Birmingham. And King said, I want you to think about this. Some of us may not come back from Birmingham alive. And he would get somber because he wanted them to think about it. But then King was a jokester with those preacher guys. They were raucous, rowdy, excuse the phrase, badass guys sometimes. They had a little truckers in them, quite honestly. And he would say, now you all think the Klan's going to get me, but you'll be jumping out in front of the camera and you're going to get you. But I will preach you the best funeral you ever had. And he would go around and say, now, Andrew Young, of all my people, nobody loved white people more than Andy Young. He would pick on one little thing with each one to tease them. And what Young told me is King was teaching us to accept the possibility of our death. Some would have to die so others would live. So King knew how to think of death, but how should we think of his death? First off, not as a feel-good figure who makes us say, oh, look how far we've come. We solved all that. He would reply, there are always wounded travelers on the Jericho Road. There are people without jobs, without health care. There are people who are hungry. And he would also say the arc of the universe doesn't bend towards justice by itself. People have a responsibility to bend the arc. They must do the bending. So to remember King properly then is not to cry for him, but to remember the principles for which he fought and to try to enact them in one's life. Even though it was written for a different circumstance, John Paul White's simple song provides a haunting coda to Dr. King's death. And I want to say two things about before John Paul comes out. The very soulfulness of John Paul's writing and singing is a testimony to something the people in the Shoals knew, that soul and soulfulness no race monopolizes and no musical genre. You listen to Dan Penn and Spooner, Oldham doing Dark End of the Street, and it's got a country twang. And you listen to another version of it, and it's pure R&B. And you listen to other things that are country soul, and King was saying, and King, who loved opera, understood that song is something that we all use to express our deepest world. And John Paul's voice reminds us of that. Ernest Davis, the great singer of the Midnighters, told me early on when I was asking him some lame question, in which I hadn't been schooled by you local folks enough. He said, come here, listen to my first song. It's hardcore country. Said, we don't worry about the labels, racial or musical. There's a second thing about simple song that I want to just anticipate so you focus on it. The lyrics, I'm not going to lose sleep when you're safe from harm. That's how Coretta thought about it. Your daddy, she told the kids, is now safe from harm. I will cry for you no more. Again, John Paul is a different context, but this is what King would have wanted. When he comes calling, death comes calling, I will let you go, but I will remember, I will remember, I will remember. I give you John Paul White.
Calling, I will live.
our seventh and final movement, Incantation. In closing, we return to our starting point, the great Muscle Shoals heritage and one of its primal songs, the Staple Singers classic, I'll Take You There. Repeated over and over, the phrase becomes an incantation, casting its magical spell, as if chanting, I'll take you there, will transport you there. The character of the there, to which Mavis Staples wants to take us, helps illuminate the character of the here. It's a place where ain't nobody crying, ain't nobody worried. Above all, no smiling faces lying to the races. Clearly, there is a dreamlike state, a possibility, a place to aspire to, a vision of a better world and thus a rebuke of injustice in our world, something people must create and not just in song. And yet, a half a century ago, a bit of the there did exist here, right here in the Shoals, out on Jackson Highway, in Fame Studios, above the old drugstore on Seminary. Maybe it started for some just as work, transactional thing, but the work of music could work its own magic. Mavis Staples said of David Hood and Barry Beckett and Roger Hawkins and Jimmy Johnson, and let's throw Spooner Oldham and Eddie Hinton into the mix, this was a rhythm section to die for. Respect flowed in both directions across the border of race, and soul was not something monopolized by a single race. As Mavis said, they were funky and they helped make us sound funky. Before long, the Staple Singers were hugging everybody, baptizing their new brothers and sisters with nicknames. David Hood became Little David. Jimmy Johnson became Jimmy Mac. Some of you old heads out there may remember the Marvelettes. Jimmy, I won't sing, now that would be wrong. Jimmy Mac. In time when black and white together still provoke glares in the Shoals, and we're already in the early 70s, Jimmy Johnson's parents would host dinners for them. There's the point, and I'll take you there, when Mavis turns to Sheffield's own David Hood and enlists his help. David, little David, help me, please. She's inviting that legendary bass solo to help take us all toward that place where there are no smiling faces lying to the races. And I'm just going to just add one quick thing, and then the musicians can come up. We're going to have the Ascending Voices come up in 1 minute, and to join us, that great bass player, proud graduate of UNA's music program, and great man in the great Midnighters, and I feel myself proud that I've not only seen the Midnighters in Elks clubs in Florence and Sheffield, I've seen them in Parker Place. And when Libby Counts introduced me by saying, I walked in late and said, oh, John's come all the way from New York, I had asked at the intermission, was that a good way to be introduced in Parker's Place? I wasn't sure. So what better way? First, I want to thank all the musicians for giving us their heart and soul and the kind of music that embodied King's King and the spirit that he often was in. And what better way to close out the evening? What better way to quote Martin Luther King? He said this in Selma, he said it in Birmingham the night he got out of jail, to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. Marcus, come on out, Ascending Voices, and thank you all for coming out tonight. And as they're sneaking up, just one more heartfelt feeling. Thanks to the Nelson family who really make this all possible and keep history alive, and all the musicians who kept history alive and in the spirit. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming out.